Good evening, guys. Before we get started tonight, just wanted to let you know about some staff changes that were happening here at Working on the Dad Pod. Ethan is no longer our audio engineer. He is also no longer in charge of quality control, and he had his password changed to his account and now has parental controls on all of his devices. I'm sorry, but I'm not sorry that that happened, because I think it is glorious. And for any of you that stuck around for all 12 minutes of that and are back this week, you're the real MVP. So thank you. And Ethan, is there anything you want to say to the people, or do you just want to get into the episode?
I just want to say I'm sorry, and that Alex might actually be needed after all.
Can you do the dance again? You can do the dance. Welcome back to the Working on the Dad Pod. I'm Alex. With me, as always, is Ethan, who also sometimes goes out on his own. Welcome back. Tonight, we are talking about home problems, when things that may sound a little wrong, we may workshop that title on the title card and the title there, not sure. Domestic disputes, but issues that come up at the house. We've got some that are currently happening and some others that have happened to us, but it is more than just when your schedule gets thrown off because your kid's sick, but like when a mild catastrophe comes along. If any of you go back to our financial episode and talk about like a rainy day savings, we're sort of talking about those rainy days, both literally in my case right now and figuratively maybe in Ethan's case. Before we do that, we'll have a story time, and after that we'll be working on the dad bod. Ethan, how you doing, man? How's your vacation?
Realized vacation was good. As I mentioned, if you were able to hear it last week, I went to my grandmother's 95th surprise birthday. She was surprised and survived the surprise, which is always a risk with a 95-year-old woman. So that is good to go. It was a great opportunity where we got the whole family together, except for my younger brother, which I can hold over him for a while. But everybody else made it, which was great. And you know, the girls had a great time with my grandma, with my mother. They met some cousins they had never met before. Same thing with aunts and uncles. I had a lot of extra babysitting hands, which was great for my wife and I. One night in the hotel, my daughter slept over in my mother's room. So with the baby in the crib that we had reserved, my wife and I each took a double bed and we just sprawled out. It was pretty nice. Probably the best night of the trip, if we're being totally honest, because we both had a lot of space and got to play golf with my cousin and my uncle. Overall, pretty solid trip. How about you? You went to a much more different trip than I went on.
Yes, I also went to New York, but then just that was a layover, and went to Scotland. It was a lot of fun. Went without the kids, which was great. They stayed here, went to school, did all their normal stuff. Shout out to my mother-in-law and my mom, who both had the kids over for sleepovers. Well, my mom did. My mother-in-law stayed at our house so that the kids could stay in their beds and keep their routine as normal as possible, as well as take care of our pets. So shout out to both of them. That was super awesome. It was great to get away with my wife for our anniversary. I will say the one downside in Scotland, most of the hotel rooms, and I think my wife could have booked around this, but most of our hotel rooms actually had just one double bed. And so for the two of us who normally share a king size bed, it was a little bit of snug quarters a couple times. I don't think you realize what you have until it's gone in there, but a lot of fun time, a lot of whiskey sampling, a lot of actually really good food. So yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed that. But you talking about your grandmother's surprise reminds me of the Dumb and Dumber scene at the beginning of the movie where he's going to get some change because he locks his wallet in like the old newspaper dispensers that they used to have. And this nice lady comes by and he goes, "Can you watch my stuff? Don't go diet on me," and walks away. That's just true. Kind of, and she bears a kind of not passing resemblance to your grandma. So I think it kind
Yeah, they're kind of similar. Question: in Scotland, when you're drinking scotch, do they just call it whiskey?
Yes, they just call it whiskey. I never ordered scotch. I ordered whiskey.
Okay. However, if you wanted to buy not scotch whiskey, did they serve it? And did they call it what it's like? Would you just say a bourbon? Or
well, a bourbon. I mean, obviously, you'd have stuff like Jameson, which is Irish whiskey, right? Sure. Obviously not scotch, but they would have that on sort of the others because basically they would just list it out, you know, by regions, almost like if you're going to France or something and they list out their wines by the region or Napa or wherever, they'd list it out like lowlands, highlands, this is where this came from. And then they'd say international whiskeys, or they might say American whiskey or something like that. Cause I know there's also like Japanese whiskey. So there's different variations, but yeah, they just called it whiskey and they sort of delineated it by that. Obviously they do call bourbon bourbon because it is considered, it is whiskey, but it's really one is made with barley scotch.
Sure.
There's made with corn. And so they're just kind of, it's kind of the same process, but not really. So, but it really interesting. I took a tour of the oldest working distillery, continuously working distillery in Scotland. So that was,
which one's that?
It is the Glenturret.
Oh, and cool. So, nice.
The Glenturret, they sell whiskey here. The Triple Wood is their sort of flagship basic whiskey for anybody listening. They sell it at Total Wine. So pretty available around the States, including the one here locally to me. It's not always in stock. They don't send a bunch of it, but it's pretty good. But the other highlight of that trip is they were bought by a crystal company. So their bottles are really beautiful, but then that crystal company put in a restaurant at the distillery and it has 2 Michelin stars. And so we got to go there for lunch, a very nice lunch after the whiskey tour.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Jealous.
So that's a little bit of stories. You got any other stories?
Yeah, I've got one. It's a very short story, but with a slightly longer preamble in that my older daughter is going through a phase right now. She's almost 5. She's in a new classroom, new grade, new teacher, and she's had a much harder time saying goodbye. You know, she will not full on cry always, but she'll whine when I have to go. It is very reminiscent of when she first started preschool, slash daycare, which is really tough. But she also is extremely emotional, more so than normal, where anything can shatter her into tears right now. And I'm a little worried because I hope she's not depressed, but it's just she's very emotional and crying a lot to the point where this after dinner, she was done. I was sitting at the table with the 2-year-old baby, and the 2-year-old goes, "My socks," and pulls her socks off and hands them to me. And she goes, "Put in laundry, daddy." My daughter walked by and I said, "Hey, can you put these in the laundry?" She said, "Yeah." So I handed her the socks. Next thing you know, she turns around and she goes, "Daddy, I accidentally put the socks in the trash can," because the trash can's right next to the laundry. And sure. I was about to laugh, and she just started crying and felt terrible. And my wife and I are just there laughing because we're saying, no, you didn't do anything wrong. You're not in trouble. I've literally put stuff in the trash when I haven't meant to before. It happens. And, you know, so I guess I'm just saying, I wish I knew why my kid is just constantly on the verge of tears right now. And I hope it's just a thing, a phase, a something. So,
yeah. I mean, obviously I don't know specifically what's going on with your daughter, but I know that over the past few weeks, my daughter went through the transition of changing classes and schools and all that, starting kindergarten. And I could tell that it's just been emotionally tough on her. And so we've tried to divide out some more one-on-one time with her and my wife. And it seems to help in fits and spurts. It's not like a do this once and it's going to fix everything kind of thing. Sure. But she's definitely been having some more of those emotional things. And one thing that we've been dealing with this week that's been really frustrating, that kind of like you, I don't have some happy ending or solution, is she's gotten in this bad habit of, you know, she and her brother fight over stuff all the time. This is mine. I found it first. I want it. Give me that. Okay. Siblings do that. But my daughter's gotten in a bad habit of like antagonizing my son and intentionally trying to make him upset to get a reaction out of him, which is kind of funny because like he'll obviously give it. He's not a statue, but I'm like, if these tables were turned, you would be freaking out like the Incredible Hulk because she is the more emotional of the kids. Fine. That's who she is. I'm not blaming her. And I'm not even saying that's a bad thing, but I do kind of find it kind of funny, but trying to work with her on this antagonistic streak, because my son, who's 2.5, will say, I found it first. And then my daughter will say, no, I found it first. You can't have it. And then she'll like go hide it and go, you're never going to find it. You can't ever have it. It's mine. And trying to explain to her the difference between him being 2.5, not trying to upset her, just trying to say statement of fact, it's mine. I want ownership of this, versus her right. being like, I am pushing your buttons to make you more upset, even after I've already possessed the thing and prevent you from getting it. And tonight it was a treasure map that came in like a Chick-fil-A kids meal. So these are not Pride's possessions. It's a rolled up piece of paper that they've had for about a week now. So I sure. you know, it's always the dumbest stuff too that gets them worked up. But yeah, I'm hoping that we can sort of get through to her, like, basically don't be a jerk. Cause it just, I don't know. It's frustrating for everybody involved because it goes from a classic, okay, let's figure out a fair way to share and all this kind of stuff, to like, holy crap, you're being mean and antagonizing him. And I've got a whole separate thing despite the ownership dispute we've got going on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So let's turn the page to something happy and talk about home disasters.
I wanted to tell you why I brought this up. So on Monday, when my family got back from our trip to New York, my wife says to me, she goes, we have mold. And I said, what? She goes, look at this. And I said, just to show how much worse I am at home ownership than other people, I said, oh, that's not just some dirt that just didn't get vacuumed up. She goes, no, that's growing something. And I said, oh. And then something triggered in my mind. And about a year ago, we had our one-year-old new HVAC compactor at the time gave out because it got too hot, it worked too hard, and it had this huge leak, combination of its Freon and water. And I spent many a nights wet vacing because the AC would shut off. So I would wet vac, I would pat it down. I knew that the drywall in the garage where next to the HVAC probably got a little bit wet, but I did not realize how bad it was. Apparently, it was so bad that the water went through the drywall and grew some mold in the in-between of the drywall from the garage and the drywall to our bottom floor of the house that goes around a utility closet. And I called I did a quick Google business search, found a local company that does mold removal. They came by Tuesday evening, and basically the guy says, hey, you've got some fungus growing. And I said, oh, so it's not mold. And he goes, well, I mean, it is, But I can't say that without you doing the $250 test on it. So I could just call it fungus and we both know it's mold, or you could spend more money and I could definitely tell you for sure it's mold. And I was like, all right, fungus it is. So they're coming tomorrow and it's going to involve cutting at least a total of about 24 feet of drywall between the garage and my house. It's going to take 3 days for the for all the machinery to work. We can't use the garage and in that time because he doesn't want us to mess up the temperature and wants to make sure that it all clears out.
Sure.
This company doesn't do the repair though. So luckily we have a painter that we've used the last couple times who also does kitchens and other things. And I texted him and said, hey, we've got another job for you. It's going to involve some drywall. I gave him the backstory and he came by today. And luckily between the two companies, between the mold removal people and him, because he's, you know, we're a repeat customer, the whole thing is going to cost less than our insurance deductible. So okay, we're not going to file a home insurance claim.
Yeah,
because you know, we don't, because it's not worth raising our home insurance if, you know, we have to pay this money anyway out of our, so, you know, luckily this we discovered this today or, you know, this week and not a month ago when we were having severe financial issues, but this literal emergency fund, you know, that was just refilled is not now just a little bit, you know, we'll have a little bit less. And I wish, I guess part of this is you're a lot more handy than me and you're able to do a lot more work. Sounds like from, if I did a little bit of research, I might be able to do this on my own, but frankly, it is at that price point where I'd rather just pay to get it professionally done well than take the risk and possibly do it wrong, especially with all the mold and everything. So.
Yeah. And I think it all depends. I mean, we had, and I know you know this story, but I don't think I've shared it on the podcast about, we used to have, you know, this is just sort of like one thing compounding another, like a comedy of errors. We live across the street from some outdoor cats. And I promise this will become relevant quickly. And those outdoor cats, when we first moved in, would come into our backyard and they'd stand by these floor to ceiling windows that we have, and they basically antagonize our indoor cat. And I'm like, fine, whatever. It's not the end of the world. Our cat, kind of like my son, doesn't actually get that riled up in comparison to other cats. She's just like mildly miffed. Well, then we get a dog. The cats leave. And all of a sudden, we realize the cats were in our backyard because they were rat hunting. And we start getting rats. And we see rats in the yard. And then I start hearing them clawing at the baseboards next to my desk, which is like in a corner of the house. And I'm like setting up like rat traps, rat poison underneath our porch that lines up with this wall. And we've got this porch that, you know, is maybe raised 6 inches or so off the ground. It doesn't have like railing or anything. It was just essentially a step and then onto a whole big platform. I get so fed up with this process and having to put these rat traps in places that are hard to reach and sticking my hands in places that are hard to reach and navigating a rat trap in that so that my daughter couldn't get into them and risking her or the dog accidentally getting into the rat poison traps they set. And I'm like, okay, I'm done with this porch. The grass can just grow over here. So I take a sledgehammer to the porch, right? You talk about me being handy. But it's just like, okay, I'm trying to solve one problem. Instead of just calling the exterminator like I should have done, which ends up being the end result of this, I decide I'm just going to take a sledgehammer to it so there's no like dark, wet space for the rats to be congregating. They're more out in the open. They have nowhere to hide. Rats like places that they can sort of tunnel and be out of the way of predators. Well, I do that and I realize they didn't put flashing between the porch and the house. And for those of you that don't know what flashing is, it's that thin metal stuff that you often see around doors and things like that. And it's a moisture barrier to keep moisture out. And so nobody put that between the wood deck and the wood siding of my wall. And so that's like rotting. I realized, I'm like, okay, well, we've got a problem that this is rotting. And all of a sudden it becomes a big problem of like, okay, now we have to replace the siding. Well, we start to replace the siding. We take a little bit of it off. And then we realize, well, that wood doesn't look right. It's not just rotting. We've got termites. So termites had gotten in there. So we then had to call the exterminator and we're like, hey, while you're out here, what are you going to do? You want to do something about the rats too? Because we had a rat problem. And I'm glad I did it, right? The moral of the story is not like, don't just take on everything yourself. Like maybe that's something you can take away. But at the same time, if I had just gotten the exterminator out to just deal with the rats, I would have never known that my wall was rotting, let alone that maybe I had termites, because they may not have had expected it because you couldn't see anything from the painted siding. It was just the 2x4s, the framing of it inside. But yeah, I can quickly see how these projects can escalate. And for us, to what you're saying, we didn't end up redoing the drywall. We did end up redoing the siding. We painted it all ourselves. If I had to do it, we are going to have to do it because there is some mild rot on the front facade, 90 degrees from this wall, that we haven't touched for a couple of years because it just hasn't gotten worse and it's not that big of a deal and the wall's not about to come down. We have decided that we are going to get a professional for that because it was such an undertaking, but you get to a certain point in the process where you've decided to do it yourself, that a professional coming in and undoing it is actually probably going to cost you more money because they're going to want to undo all the like self-done stuff that you did. Right. And so we, you know, get to that point of no return. So it's, yeah, I can definitely understand the appeal to getting a professional in there to just get it done and get it done right. Especially with something like mold, you know, what I'm talking about with rot wasn't mold. It was just like the disintegration of the wood. So it wasn't as much of a health hazard as much of like structural concern.
Right. Sure. Sure. And you know, one thing my dad actually taught me was to, you know, take on some little projects. When you finally own a home, learn what you're good at. Just always pay for what you know you're bad at. For example, I will never touch electrical beyond like, can I try unplugging and plugging it back in to see if that solved the problem? I am fairly decent at plumbing, but drywall, I mean, obviously I can paint, sure.
Yeah.
But drywall and, you know, just replacing, like, even if it's not structural, but the actual structure, that's not my jam.
I will say that the drywall itself is not the siding was the worst, like having to individually cut the pieces. Cause it's not just cutting straight lines. It's like, you got to cut corners to go around windows and door frames and all that stuff. And then nailing each one of them in manually, because sometimes a nail gun can actually puncture the siding or something like that. And so, yeah, I don't touch much of the electrical. The one thing I will do is like, I can change out an outlet. So if an outlet's gone bad, or I need to install a GFCI outlet that'll trip if like water gets in it, you know, I can change one of those, but any like in-wall wiring, I tend to stay away from. My father-in-law was really handy with that. So when we did this shed and put up the drywall in here, you know, that's how I know that the drywall itself isn't that hard, because it had a metal exterior, so there's no siding to do, but the drywall itself wasn't too bad. But because we didn't have any drywall on it and we were just like replacing framing, we were able to go through and do the wiring in sort of this big open canvas and connect it and make sure everything looks right, versus like trying to drill holes and do essentially microsurgery like electricians will do to not damage as much of the drywall as possible, because there just wasn't any in here. It was just a freestanding metal shed. That's the only time we've really touched the electrical. But in the house, yeah, no, we're going to have to do that. If we ever get an electric vehicle, we're going to have to, you know, like get our breaker box upgraded to a bigger capacity, because we're basically right at the limit of what our house can hold. So we can't add any more things that would suck a lot of power without essentially shutting down the grid every time we do.
Huh. Interesting. Well, it's also good to know that you know how to replace outlets and change to GFCIs, because I've been meaning to do that for about 5 years, but the next time you come, I'll make sure all of the replacements are there.
it's honestly the biggest thing with that one is it's not that hard, and it's really not that dangerous as long as you do the very simple thing of like, okay, you need to take this outlet that works and install a new outlet that has this tripping function. Okay, well, you just turn off the breaker to it, and then you take like a lamp and plug it in, or like a phone charger and plug it in. And if it doesn't give you power, then you're like, okay, I tripped the right breaker. And if no electricity is coming in, then you're good. And you just make sure everything's attached. Those are pretty easy. They just like click the wire in and then it clicks and you're good. And you just like four wires. That's not bad. Right. But good on the homeowner's insurance, that's the reason I did it. The homeowner's insurance like inspection was like, hey, you don't have enough GFCIs. You need this many like codes of change and stuff. And here, you know, termite damage, anything kind of damage, man, we're not calling our homeowner's insurance. It's not even a deductible question for us, because in Florida, homeowner's insurance is so chaotic that it's like, you need like an act of God to file a claim, because otherwise it's not just a rate hike. They'll probably just cancel your coverage and you'll have to hopefully find somebody else.
Wow.
Absolute chaos.
That's nuts. Well, to bring it back to parenting, what I will say is it wasn't just me opportunity to complain to our millions of viewers that I have to deal with mold. I mentioned how we can't use the garage. Now, what does that mean? In practicality, we park outside, but using the garage and not only stores the car, but our strollers. And part of my morning routine is exiting the house with the girls through the garage to get to the stroller to take them to preschool. Now, one would think that at almost 36 years old, I can do a good enough job remembering to not use the garage door for 3 days. And I hope that is the case. It might actually be
like
a week.
Blue painter's tape over the seal, or like a sign, or something.
That's a good idea. Maybe I'll do that.
Yeah.
Anyway, point is, it does impact my routine with the girls. So, but this is a situation where, you know, just last thing you want to do when you come back from vacation, and I know you know this, is to just jump on a problem and start researching and calling. And realizing that all your plans were to just eat, shower, put the kids to bed, and hopefully go to sleep yourself or watch some trash TV.
Yeah.
But no, now you're just back into full home ownership, parent, must fix everything mode.
Yeah. It's always something. I mean, we had that. And I think it can be tough on everybody, but it is tough on the kids when that happens. As I mentioned on the show just last month, our AC broke, right? And as I just mentioned, obviously we're in Florida. And so that's no bueno in August in Florida. And so luckily we got it replaced within 24 hours or 27 hours of noticing the problem, which was great. I basically just called a bunch of highly rated AC techs in my area. Being in Florida, there are quite a few. Sure. So called somebody. We chose a model that they had in stock and they got it done by 5 o'clock the next day. But you realize that the house becomes untenable pretty quickly. Like, that's how we noticed there was a problem. We're like, man, the AC is just not like kicking on. It's 82 degrees in here. It's 84 now. What are we doing? And so we're all trying to huddle in here in the studio, which has a split duct. It's not on the central air. And so we're trying to come in here where it's a nice whatever we set at temperature, and had to decamp to my mom's house for the night. And my mom's got a 2-2 condo. And so my mom was sleeping on like a pull out that she's got in her living room. And my wife and I are sleeping in her bed and the kids are sleeping in the guest room. And it's a little more chaos where like, got to wake up, you know, we've got a pretty tight morning routine. You know, kids are up at 6:30. Daughter and I are out the door no later than 7 to get her to school on time. So it's a very sort of tight turnaround that we've got going on. And so doing all that and moving that entire routine to another place, even just for a night, and maybe it's worse because it's just for a night, because you're like panicking and going, okay, well, it's already 6 o'clock. We need to get the kids fed. We're not going to stay in the house and cook. We've got to figure out where we're going to go to dinner. We've got to make sure we have everything we need. We've got to make sure that the pets are taken care of. We've got to make sure that we have everything we need, especially for my daughter, for school in the morning, because there just is not time to come back to the house
right
in the morning before going to school. We got to figure something out. And so, yeah, those times can be chaotic and they can be hard on the kids. And like, my kids shared a double or queen size bed, whatever my mom has in there. And they didn't go to sleep right away because they're excited because they're sharing a bed and they're talking and playing and like having to pop in and go to sleep, guys, go to sleep. Okay. Your bedtime is 8 o'clock and it's 9:15. I need you to go to sleep. Right. Like, it's right. been well over an hour. You've got like, what am I going to do? Separate you? Like, there's nowhere else to put you. So, sure. Just all those kind of things are definitely a headache. But I think the best thing that can try to do, and it's tough, especially in those moments, is just keep a calm head. And I'm always the guy, like, you know, that says communication, but just sort of like, my wife and I talked over the plan, distracted the kids with something, like they're in here playing with like exercise bands and stuff, so we could have a conversation without their input, and just developed a plan so that we're like, okay, this is how we're going to handle it. This is what I'm concerned about. This is what you're concerned about. Here's what we need to do. Here's what I need to do. And like, let's get all our ducks in a row, but staying calm will help the kids not be freaked out. And I think will help their reaction to the situation when mom and dad are like, hey, we're going to Gigi's house for a sleepover, and not like, okay, the house is broken. Everything's terrible. Get in the car. Let's go. We've got to go to your grandmother's house to blah, 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 blah. But like, putting on a fun face, we get to go out to dinner. We're going to go to the hot dog restaurant. Aren't you excited? Like, and then we're going to go to Gigi's house for a sleepover. Yay. And then it becomes a lot more fun. And then that helps. And then obviously they figured out what was going on and why we were doing all that. But by the time they got home the next day, air conditioner was soft. So no harm, no foul.
Yeah. Well, that's good. You know what I realized?
What?
I forgot to prepare for working on the dad bod. So. Oh. So I'm going to hit the pause button and go break the fourth wall with all of you. I'm going to go weigh myself and I'm going to come right back.
Take your computer.
Oh, yeah. No, that's for our OnlyFans account.
This is where I get to talk smack about Ethan while he's not here. And I'm just going to, you know, leave this part in, because who needs Ethan? My audio sounds great. I'm doing great. And we're going to pause it. And he's not going to know until he listens back to it whenever we post this live.
Nobody even knew I was gone.
Not at all.
No. Anyway, wish I didn't do that because I don't like my results. So let's just skip it this week. No, just kidding.
Hey, that's fine.
No. No. How about, I'll just say I'm in a mode of fluctuation right now. I don't know. 2 weeks ago, I was 2 pounds heavier than I am now. Last week, I was 4 pounds lighter than I am now. So I don't really know what's going on with my body, but it's not great. So 189.4 today, not happy about it. I will say that I did not have the best exercise week this week. I ate pretty well, mostly because I spent all day Monday driving back from New York. And then on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, I was just catching up a lot from work and didn't really have an opportunity to step away. So, yeah. You know, no excuses. That's just how my schedule laid out. So,
yeah. Well, yeah. For me, it's been, you know, when we talked a couple weeks ago, it was like I was having that impromptu deload week, just sure. from all the aches and pains and the stress. And so going to Scotland and sleeping in slightly smaller beds and all that stuff, I didn't like recover. You know, whiskey apparently is not recovery fuel. Sure. I didn't drink that much of it, but you know, between that and pints and various things, it just, you know, it was a beautiful vacation, but it wasn't the most relaxing. But I was able to, luckily I was smart enough to, we got back on Sunday and I took the day off on Monday so nice. That I could go back and nap. And I worked out at the end of the day. I didn't work out in the morning, because basically my wife and I slept in here on an air mattress because we got back so late because my mother-in-law was in our bed taking care of the kids. And so my mother-in-law was able to help usher the kids out the door, get them to where they needed to go. And that was totally fine. And I was able to get back at it. But luckily have been feeling pretty good about my workouts. Went pretty heavy the last few days. So great. I don't have any big insights or anything of anything I'm doing. I'm just getting back at it in the gym, and it does feel nice after really 2 weeks of not doing much. I will say I did get plenty of steps. They have something in Scotland that they do not have in Florida, hills. Did some hiking, did some just walking. And unlike walking around Florida, it's a lot easier to just build up activity minutes on your watch from just walking around a city or something. So
sure.
It's nice.
Well, cool. I'm sure all of our listeners are really glad you're back, because I don't think they want it to ever be just me again. So, you know, I've learned my lesson. I thought I could do it without you. I cannot.
I think maybe you just, you know, you got to do a dry run. As one of our friends would say, and test out the microphone, make sure all the connections are secure before you pop it on the feed.
Sure. Yeah. Right. Yeah. It's a shame. It was a fun topic I discussed for anybody who could decipher it.
I would love to hear it someday.
Yeah.
Ooh. All right, guys. Well, this was a pretty short and sweet one. You can tell we're both having a little home emergency fatigue and vacation fatigue. So that's kind of it for us tonight. But we thank you for watching, and we'll be back with something else next week, maybe a little bit longer, hopefully with good audio yet again. And we thank you for tuning in and listening to us, and subscribe on YouTube, wherever you get your podcasts, do all that stuff. I realized I forgot to say at the beginning of the episode. So let's go ahead and, you know, make sure you head to workingonthedadpod.com to find all our social medias, all our episodes, all our feeds, all the various things. We'll catch you next time.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for working on the Dad Pod with us. Any resources that we mentioned during the show will be in the show notes. If you have questions, thoughts, or just want to talk with us, the best place is in the comments on YouTube. We're on YouTube, TikTok, Instagram, and Threads at Working on the Dad Pod, and on Twitter at Working on Dad Pod. Following and subscribing is always appreciated. Please rate and review us. That helps get the show to new people. And if you know a dad who would enjoy our show, sharing it with them is a huge help to them and us. Have a great week.
I didn't think you'd let me do this.
I'm not going to end it until you stop.